Today, LSI product managers introduce the ideal applications for LSI 6 gigabit per second SAS switch and how to easily configure the switch as a cost-effective, scalable, high-performance storage device.
Hi, I'm Bruce Griesaber, product manager from LSI, representing the SAS switch product line. I'm here today to show you the switch and how do you use it in the rack environment. It's the industry's first high-performance SAS switch available in the market today. It allows you for creating a simple, low-cost, high-performance storage solution. So if we look at, we have multiple versions of the switch that are available today, a 1U full-width rack model with internal power supply, and a half-U version that is designed to slip into a 1U rack shelf, giving you a dual domain configuration. Included in the SAS switch product line is the integrated storage management software solution, which allows the full control of the SAS switch and the devices that it's controlling in the domain. With that comes interoperability testing to the storage enclosures and full plug and play that allows for a simple out of the box experience. The LSI switch provides multiple benefits in the DAS environment. It allows you to connect basically a storage device, a drive, to a single server. By setting up zoning, you can control basically the connections of each individual drive in all the JBODs and storage boxes in the rack. It's easy to reconfigure because the reconfiguration of those drives now are in software under the management tool. As you can see in the front of the rack switch, there are 16 SAS connections that allow you to hook up any combination of servers and storage enclosures or other switches. You can cascade them. Also, there's an Ethernet for outer band management and a power connection. If you look at what's the advantage you have in using a SAS switch in a DAS environment, it allows you basically for better utilization of your external storage. You can put the storage on the servers that need the storage at the time. It improves the server cooling because you're basically distributing the storage across a full rack size. Tiered storage is another big feature that SAS provides in the fact that you can use SAS drives that allow for full high availability, high reliability, or you can use SATA drives in the same environment that allows you for maximum size and capability. SAS in generally is a much lower cost solution for storage interconnect. The SAS switch is a scalable DAS device that allows you to basically expand your rack environment. So what we're allowed to be able to do is take multiple servers and multiple storage enclosures and hook those together, and with zoning capability, being able to control security of which devices is connected to which devices. And as part of this demo, I will show that in using the management tool of setting up zoning between the different servers and the storage. And the ease of use of this allows you to do reconfiguration on the fly. Today in our demo, what we'll show you is a typical rack server environment that you would find in an SMB or a medium-sized enterprise. What we have in the rack is down towards the bottom, three 2U servers that are interconnected to the SAS switch using SAS HBAs. Above them in the top, we have four storage enclosure boxes. These are standard SAS JBODs with up to 16 drives per JBOD. In the back of the switch, we have the SAS switch, which uses the standard SAS cables to connect between the HBAs in each server and the enclosures. And with the management tool for the SAS switch, we can assign drives in each or any of the enclosures to the appropriate SAS server. And at any time, we can reconfigure that. Now I'm going to show you, as part of the demo, the SAS Domain Manager software suite, which is the overriding software that runs embedded on the SAS switch. What we'll show you is any Internet Explorer can call it up. What you'll see here is I'm calling it up, attached to it the IP address, which is the normal default IP address of it. and it comes up asking you for a it's password protected, so you get a user's name and a user's password. And from here, it will call up the management tool and allow me to look at the topology of my configuration, allows me to set up the zoning, allows me to look at environmentals, and being able to also upload new firmware on the SAS switch all through the same management tool. So here, you can see that this is the management tool comes up in the what we call the summary tab. What it shows is what the active zone set is enabled. In this case, we have none enabled, and I will show what that impact of that is. It shows the environmentals if there's any issues going on. We have tabs that show the topology of the switch, of the SAS domain, starting with the switch at the high end, working its way down through the three servers, then the enclosures, which is the expanders that are in the enclosures, and then each of the storage elements in the enclosures. I'm gonna switch over to show you what one of the servers see in this environment. So if you look at, this is one of the servers in the configuration, and what you see here, I'm running the disk manager, and you can see all of the drives that the server sees. And if I click over to the other servers, you'll see the same thing, that all the drives are shown on each server. So right now there's no security between servers, and there's no setting up who owns what storage. In this mode, everybody can see everybody. So the next step would be for the manager is to set up zoning, and we'll do that next. So I'll go back to my management software package. And to set up zoning, we do what we call the end device wizard. The end device wizard gives us a list of all of the HBAs or servers that are attached, and all of the end devices. And what you'll see is, I'll point out, is that we are using aliases here instead of a SAS address. In the case of the hard drives, we have some alias and also SAS addresses set up. So first thing to do is name it zone set one, I'm sorry, zone group one. We'll talk about zone sets in a second. And pick a server, pick some different drives. You don't have to pick them in order. I can pick them across JBODs. Try to go down, pick one down here at the bottom. I do define the zone group, hit next, and hit apply. And what I've just done now is set up a zone group that assigns, in this case I think it was four hard drives to the first server. So what I'll do next is set up another one. I'll do, in this case, server three. If you remember, I picked the first hard drive, so I'll pick something here in the middle. And pick one next to it, and two down here. Name this zone group two, define it, next, and apply. So you would normally go through the sequence of all your resources assigning a configuration that is appropriate for the environment that you need. You can reconfigure this on the fly very easily by just changing or modifying zone groups and reinitializing them. The next step I'm gonna do is generate what we call a zone set. Zone set, think of it as the anding of zone groups. If I have, in this case, two zone groups and I want them both to be activated, I need to activate both. I can't activate one at a time. I'm only allowed one zone set activated at any time, but I can have as many zone groups as I want. So I can come here and say, basically, let's call this zone set one. And what I do is just pick resources here. You can see I can have everybody talk to everybody, and this would set the servers up that they can see each other and see each other shared storage, basically. Or what I can do is set them up that zone set one only sees zone set one, and zone set two only sees zone set two. So I will apply that. and that's done. So again, you can have multiple zone sets, you can have multiple zone groups at any time, but only one zone set activated. So now I can activate the zone set. If you remember the servers, when they first came up, they saw all the storage that was in the environment. So I pick zone set one, I hit apply, and it says okay. Let me close, go back here. But what I'm gonna do next is go back and look at, in this case, this is server one, and you can see here now in the storage manager, it instead of having all of the 42 drives that are available in the rack, I have only set up 4 drives. And if you look at server two was never set up in a zone, so it does not see any of those storage other than the drive that's internally to it. And then server three, you see, again, it has the 4 drives that are available that were set up in the zone groups. Other ways to look at the environment, if you go back to the topology view, what you do is you can highlight one of the servers. So you can see here that it is enabled. So if I go here now, if I highlight one of the servers or HBAs, you can see it highlights the resources that are in that zone group, or you can go over here and look at the tab and it'll tell you the resources in the zone group. In server two, you notice there's no tab because it was not set up in any zone group. And server three, it shows the drives that I have picked. So if you look at this, you know, from a ease of use, ease of reconfiguration, the SAS switch allows that. And part of this whole scalability is performance. Again, realize that each of the SAS connectors are running at 24 gigabits per second, which is the highest performance for storage today. And if you look at the aggregated bandwidth of the switch, we can run up at 384 gigabits per second. Now that I showed you how easy it is to use the LSI SAS switch in a DAS environment, being able to scale performance and scale the number of devices, you can get information on the switch from your local LSI rep or go to the LSI website at lsi.com.